I'm willing to bet that if you're going through recovery or you're going through an eating disorder in any way right now, you've probably already thought about food at some point in time today. Whether it's what you're gonna eat next, when it's going to be, how much it's going to be, you've thought about food probably maybe a lot. And it's probably not going to be the first time that you think about it today. You repeat thinking about food thoughts every day, multiple times a day, for a lot of days, that's a lot of thinking about food. That's a lot of time, energy, and thought that you could be putting into a lot of other things, a lot of just life that are being put into food. Food obsession is something that really plagues just about everyone, at least everyone that I know who is going through or has been through an eating disorder. And it's not just something that you can snap your fingers and make it go away. And it's hard to handle, especially when food needs to be a part of your everyday, your all day, every day, especially when you're in recovery. Because basically food becomes your full-time job to get better. I'm giving my best shot today on how to handle all of those food thoughts. It's not gonna be easy. Let's get started. All right, the very first thing that I want you to know, whoever's watching this, whether you're obsessed with food, whether you're not obsessed with food, wherever you're at in your process of eating disorders, I want you to know that recovery is possible. I talked to a number of people this past week on Instagram who were talking to me about like where they're at in the middle of everything, and they honestly had lost hope. Like, recovery was not even a thought for them. If you're watching this, no matter where you're at, I want you to know that recovery is possible. Even though it doesn't seem like it is, because in the middle of it, it's hard to see. Because of all the obsession, all the thinking about food, it seems like those thoughts are never going to go away. Seems like it's impossible to get a grip on this thing that is an eating disorder. And of course, then you have like the ebbs and flows of recovery and then falling back into it and everything. It's hard to handle. I want you to know though, that recovery is possible. I was there. I remember what it was like. It took me about 7 years to get to the spot where I can say that I am confidently, food does not take over any portion of my thoughts during the day. When I eat, I enjoy it, and then it's done, and it's on to the next thing. But I remember what it was like to be in the middle of it, and to ask myself if this is what it was going to be like for literally the rest of my life. And it seemed like it was. It seemed like I wasn't going to be able to escape thinking about food or obsessing or worrying about when I would go out to eat. But no, I can tell you that it is possible to not worry about food. It's gonna take time to get there. I wanna be very upfront about this video and saying that there is no thing that would be able to make me snap my fingers and say like, hey, you're cured, you don't gotta think about food anymore. And then all of a sudden you wake up the next day and you don't think about food, you don't obsess over it. No, food obsession goes hand in hand with an eating disorder. Food obsession is a symptom of an eating disorder. It might take time, but recovery is possible. Your life, the other half of your life that you haven't even lived yet outside of food is possible, and it's waiting for you on the other side of this chunk of time that is recovery. Okay, but this video really is my shot, my take on how to overcome obsession with food, how to overcome those thoughts so that you can move on to the next thing, so that you can help just alleviate a little bit of mental pressure. The answer ultimately comes in two parts. Both parts work together in unison. Both parts are just as important as each other. Let's start with part one, of course, because it would make sense to start with part two. That makes zero sense. Part one is honestly probably going to cover where a lot of us generally are right now, like as we speak. And it's probably the biggest answer. Again, I said part one and two work together, but part one really is like a huge chunk of where the underlying issue and solution is to stop obsessing over food. But the answer is also probably not what you expect. Let me explain. Let's jump back into the 1940s. Why the 1940s? Well, because there was a study done in the 1940s by a man named Ansel Keys. Ansel Keys wanted to study the effects of starvation on the body and the mind. To test this, he got together a group of 36 guys, males, interestingly enough, who were robust enough to complete the test. Basically, they were young, fit men who had good minds, basically. And they were not people with eating disorders, they were people who did not have an eating disorder. The study went in three phases. The first phase was a 12-week period of time, the control of the study, where these men ate 3,200 calories every single day. And after that 12-week phase, where they were eating 3,200 calories every single day, they went into phase two, where their calories were halved every single day. So for another 12-week period of time, these guys were eating 1,600 calories every day. And the impact of this 12-week period of time says a lot about, I think says a lot about the answers that we're looking for with food obsession. So, okay, normal guys, 36 normal guys, 3,200 calories for 12 weeks. Then for 12 weeks, their calories were halved. During that period of time, a lot of different things happened. Their days started revolving around food. They dreamed about food. They fantasized about food. They spent a lot of time talking about food and recipes. They were agitated if their mealtimes were changed. And some men just enjoyed watching other men eat. Sound familiar? Their mood changed. So they used to be lively and energetic, talking about the things that they love, reportedly a lot of politics. During the test phase, however, their focus solely got shifted into food. They became more anxious, more irritable, they became more withdrawn, less energetic. Anxiety increased, and obsessive thinking over food increased. Sound familiar? And eventually, what became really their skeletal appearance, they did not see themselves as skinny. In fact, they saw their other male counterparts as fat. Sound familiar? This study essentially accelerated the observable effects of an eating disorder. During the last phase of the test, the men who lasted until the end at least, entered into a refeeding phase. During this last period of time, it was about 6 weeks, to return to kind of a normal state, they had to eat an increased amount of calories, about 4,000 calories every single day. Does that sound familiar? The men ultimately lost about 25% of their normal body weight during the starvation phase, and then they entered into that refeeding phase. Here's the interesting thing, though. There are a couple interesting points that happened during this refeeding phase, and they're eating a lot of calories. Their body weight returned to a normal state, and as the men returned to their normal healthy weight and their normal eating habits, again, reportedly in this study, this is not me speaking, this is the study speaking, they reportedly stopped obsessing over food. They stopped comparing themselves to the other men around them. Their obsessive behavior overall just went down, and their lively, energetic selves returned to normal. Yeah, that's cool, Cam. But what does it have to do with me? That's a great question. I'm glad you asked that question. This study is an insane look into obsessive thought behavior when it comes to food restriction. There's not a more clear kind of correlation or depiction of how closely related food obsessive thoughts is with simply restricting food. As you restrict more and more food, your thoughts about food, your obsession over food starts to go up. And as you restrict less and less and you eat more and more, your food obsessive thoughts go down. The answer, the part one answer that is, again, not as clear cut, I think, as a lot of people would hope, which is why part two is coming. So stick around for part two, because part two has more stuff. The biggest answer here is refeeding over a longer period of time. In other words, the answer is, as we know it, recovery. But it's not as simple as just eating more food. That's not what this is about. Trust me, I know that can't just be the answer. But I can tell you, from someone who doesn't think about or obsess about food anymore, it took years to get to this spot. But what took years of refeeding and constantly bumping up my weight, staying at that weight for a while, bumping up my weight, staying at that weight for a while, what took years of that process eventually turned into me not obsessing over food anymore. I said this at the beginning, and I think it's true. I picture food obsession as a symptom of an eating disorder. I think a lot of people are, myself included, way back then, I wanted to figure out how to stop obsessing over food. But it's, again, not as simple as that. I think if you were to slap a Band-Aid on it and stop obsessing over food, the underlying issue of the entire thing would still be the eating disorder as a whole. It's not the food obsession that leads the eating disorder, it's the eating disorder that leads the food obsession. As you continue to refeed, as you continue to recover, it's going to take time. As you continue to do those things, though, your obsession with food will, I promise you, it will decrease. And I think there's something that it's so important for all of us to know and to recognize and look at. It's the fact that we've ingrained these men came into this, again, it was like an accelerated, in that test, it was like an accelerated version of an eating disorder, basically. But for a lot of people here, we've spent years, pretty much, ingraining these habits in our brains, in our bodies, for how we handle food. And because of that, it's not going to be as simple as just eating more food and then making the obsession go away. No, it potentially could take years of working at it, chiseling at it every single day to just get closer to recovery. And as time goes on, help take that obsession off of your mind. It's going to take time to get there. The ultimate answer is recovery. It's healing. Looking at yourself, finding yourself, and being okay with who you are. And that's what this entire channel is dedicated to. But in between where we're at now and that point in time, what can you do to help alleviate a little bit of that pressure, a little bit of that stress that's going on in your mind right now? That is what part two is all about. Part two is all about helping you along the way detach that obsession a little bit. These examples of things that I did in part two, they're not going to be like the answer. Again, like I said, really the underlying answer is recovery, it's healing. But these are things that can help you along the way, help basically speed up that process of detachment of food obsession, make it a little bit easier on yourself. Basically, on the way there, there are things that you can do to help alleviate that pressure. Combined, all of these things are really powerful and really helpful, and they were for me, mixed with recovery, mixed with working with a professional, a nutritionist, everything like that. And hopefully some content from this channel too. So what are some ways that you can help just kind of act on today to help with that food obsession detachment? Number one is to cook and bake less. I know some of you who are watching this absolutely love to cook and love to bake. This does not mean that you absolutely cannot cook or cannot bake. No. This is just saying to maybe pull back from that a little bit and do it a little bit less. People with an eating disorder have, simply put, just a fascination with food. And I was actually in that same boat. In the peak of my eating disorder, at its worst, I was obsessed with food. And I was obsessed with making food for myself, but also for other people, because I loved watching other people eat the food that I made. I had even aspirations of being a chef. I remember being in my hospital bed when I was officially diagnosed with anorexia. The person who diagnosed me basically just kind of didn't call me out, but asked me a couple questions, basically just made some assumptions about me from the very start before I told her anything about me. She basically just kind of sat back with her notepad and said, "Let me guess, you love food, you love making food, and you want to be a chef." And I looked at her and I was like, "Yeah. That's all right. I aspire to be a chef, yeah." Cooking often and baking often for and with others, I can confidently say that is what held my obsession for longer than I should have been obsessed. So now that I'm outside of my eating disorder, years outside of my eating disorder, I can say I don't want to be a chef. That's not something that I want to do. That was the eating disorder kind of putting that over me. Those thoughts, it's crazy how much an eating disorder can control for somebody, but that was one aspect of what I wanted to do in life that was being controlled by the eating disorder and by the food obsessive thoughts. The second thing is to pull away from social media food culture. So it might be looking up recipes on like different Google. Maybe you have a favorite recipe website. For me, it was All Recipes, allrecipes.com. So recipe websites, it could be food posts on Instagram, looking at them and or also posting them. See it a lot. And again, not that posting a picture of food is an inherently bad thing. That's not at all what I'm saying. Saying though is that something like that can keep you immersed in food culture and obsessed over thinking about food every single day, every single night. It's not saying to just like cut it outright, but I am saying it would be good to pull back a little bit. Blogs, Facebook posts, whatever it is, it's really hard to escape right now. Another one is to let other people cook for you. Now, this is a really tough one. I did not want to let other people, I don't want to let my mom cook for me or anybody else, let alone my mom. I wanted no one else to cook for me because I wanted to be controlling what went into my food. In my mind, like my mom was going to slip in an extra tablespoon of butter or something, and that literally freaked me out. But this is all about confronting those food thoughts, confronting those stressors, and really standing up to them, having the strength to stand up to them. Depending on where you're at, maybe it's one meal a week letting someone cook for you. Maybe it's two meals, three meals. Maybe it's every single day. Whatever it is, it's challenging yourself to push to that next level, because I promise you, doing that will help take away those food obsessive thoughts. This next one worked for me. I don't think it'll work for everybody, but I think it really helps. Again, it just helps alleviate some of that pressure. It's eating a lot of similar things. So I love eating new food. I loved eating new food then. I do do now. But eating new foods meant that I would have to, again, in my eating disorder mind, that I would look up every single one of those foods that I was making for myself or making for somebody else. But what I changed was this. I limited myself to this pool of food. In peak anorexia in high school, and I did this in college too. But I limited myself to a certain pool of food. I would make a lot of basically consistent meals that I would eat. And because of that, it really encouraged me. I knew what I was eating, and I didn't have to look up anything new, and there was no guessing. And because of that, it took a lot of the stress off my mind. I had to eat a lot of the same things over and over and over again. But for me, the stress relief and the pressure taken off of constantly looking up calories and counting it all up and adding it all up, it was worth it. For me at the time. This one might not make sense right now, but it does so clearly to me. I think it's essential in every single step of the eating disorder process, and that's simply to just talk about it. So what does talking about it look like in this context? It's just an example. When my mom would be making me food, and I'd be freaking out internally. I'd be watching her make the food, and I'd be stressed out to the max, watching her literally stir, like, whatever, what, hamburger and peas, okay? I was freaking out. I was like, man, this is way too much food. She's making way too much food. She doesn't know how to do it. She doesn't know how to do it right. But I wish I would have done that scenario in every scenario when I would freak out about food thoughts consuming my mind, about being stressed out about it. I wish I would have just told somebody, talked to somebody about it. In that moment with my mom, I wish I would have just been like, hey, mom, you know what? Just being completely honest, I'm freaking out right now about you making me food. And you know what? She probably wouldn't have said, oh, well, okay, Cameron, here, you make it. She probably wouldn't have done that. Just bringing it up and talking about it, talking through it with her, honestly would have really helped me get it out in the air, but also talk through why it's kind of like encapsulating my thoughts. If you're with friends who know what you're going through, if you're with somebody, even if you're not in that moment, bring it up, be completely honest and say, guys, I'm sorry, I'm freaking out right now. I just need some help. I need some support. And I think you'll be surprised at A, how willing other people are to help you in that time, but B, also how good it'll make you feel mentally, physically, everything. This next one goes hand in hand with if you choose to plan food out. Basically, and this is gonna take time, okay? I started doing this years in recovery, years after recovery. This was when I was in college. But it took me time to practice leaving food on the table, no pun intended. What I would do is, because I would plan food out and kind of plan for what I was going to eat in a week, right? Not every single food, but like carbs, protein, and fat, the amount that I was gonna eat every single day in a week's time, and that I had like preset meals, I would practice intentionally enjoying the food when I was eating it, but then after it was done, after I had breakfast and my snack and my lunch and my afternoon snack and my dinner, I would practice keeping myself accountable to catch my thoughts when they would go back to food. So in between, just an example, like in between breakfast and my snack, if I would catch myself thinking about, well, what's my snack going to be? Or what's lunch going to be? How much is it going to be? I would just catch myself. It would be, those food thoughts would be a trigger for me to say, hey, you promised yourself that you wouldn't think about it. You know what you're going to eat already for lunch. So it's not going to help to worry about it, to think about it even more. And I'd practice that constant, the goal was not to stop those thoughts from appearing, because I literally couldn't. I couldn't stop those thoughts from like coming up. But the goal was to improve how I handled those thoughts, right? So every time those thoughts would come up, it would be like a push down, like, no, Cam, don't think those thoughts. It would be like a gentle pull back to whatever I was focused on at the time, whether it was hanging out with friends or school or things like that. Gentle pullback, not a push down. And this one's gonna take time to get, I think, but it's important to mention, it's important for me to bring up, and it's tough to articulate. It's not avoiding food, but thinking about it in a healthy way. I have talked with a lot of people going through eating disorders, and I encountered this myself, where I would really beat myself up for thinking about food. In relation to the last one, it was like pushing it down rather than a gentle mental pullback into the moment that I was in. And I got into an unhealthy spot where I started just like ignoring the problem, really, where I wasn't thinking about food in a healthy way. It's really finding that balance of intentionally making sure that you have enough to eat in a day, but then in the end, just letting it be. You're not ignoring food, you're paying attention to it, but then you're just kind of letting it go. This last one is on your own, it's with support, it's however you can do it. In whatever extent it needs to be done, just try it. Whether it's one food today or one food next week, plan this out. But the last one is to challenge your food rules. And I'm gonna make a separate video about food rules in general. But maybe it's a certain food that you absolutely refuse to eat. Maybe it's like soda or cream and coffee or something. Whatever it is, this tip is to challenge yourself to overcome one of those things, all right? I'm sitting here challenging you to overcome one of those things this week, whatever it is. Maybe it's creaming your coffee. Maybe it's getting a dessert at some cafe that you never get dessert at, but you've always wanted to get it, right? Whatever it is, I found that challenging those food rules and overcoming those has allowed me to realize that food is not scary, that these food rules I've ingrained in myself to force myself to not eat something have been taken away from just some great enjoyment in food, healthy enjoyment in food. And I found that the less scared I was, the less I thought about it. That's it. Those are the tips to help alleviate a little bit of pressure that food is putting on your brain. Part one mixed with part two, both are essential. I think if I were to boil it all down, it's gonna be a long-term effort. Long-term can look different for a lot of different people. It could be a year for you. Maybe it is a year to overcome all this. Maybe it could be 5. Maybe it could be 7. For me, it was 7. Maybe it could be 20. Whatever it is, recovery is possible. Recovery is ultimately what it's going to take to completely relieve you 100% of food obsession. But those small things can be done along the way to, I think, help shorten that gap a little bit. So that's it. And I'm sure if I think of anything else, of course, I'll probably make another video about it. But those have been some of the biggest things that have helped me detach that food obsession. I can honestly say that now I think about food in a healthy way. And I actually still really enjoy cooking food. And I really enjoy eating food, like a lot, but in a good way. Did I miss anything? Did I miss anything in this list of tips and tricks and long-term ways to relieve food obsession? Let me know if I missed anything. Also, if you want to talk about this, something else with eating disorders or just like life in general, hit me up on Instagram. I love talking to every single one of you. If I haven't talked to you yet on Instagram, I want to. So hit me up. As always, if you want to hear me cover anything else about recovery or anorexia, eating disorders, life in general, let me know also. If you find value in this video or anything else that I'm doing, please consider subscribing. Would love to have you be a part of the health recovery crew. You all are awesome. I love every single one of you, even if I haven't met you yet. Thank you all so much for watching. I will see you next time. If you want to watch any of the other vids that I've put out recently, check out this right here. This is the vid zone, all right? Thanks, everybody. I'll catch you later.